Are you ready to worship Jesus tonight? Hey, Jesus, we love you and invite you in the room. Say, oh, 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 oh,
oh. Your cross, it draws me to your heart. It makes my spirit sing. It makes my spirit sing. Your grace. Your grace, so I hear it call my name. I'm waking up to sing. I'm waking up to sing. Your cross, it draws me to your heart. It makes my spirit sing. It makes my spirit sing. Yeah.
Your grace.
Here we go, church, say,
we will sing and shout, yeah. Sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praise.
We will
sing and shout, yeah. Sing and shout. Open up our hearts and pour your praise.
We sing for you, our God.
Yeah.
Now and forever.
Jesus who has authority. Jesus who heals the sick. Jesus. Yeah! Woo! Come on, one more big shout for our God and King tonight. We love you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen. Aren't you so grateful for that name that's above every name?
Yeah.
The name above every name, every situation that you face. Amen?
Amen.
We praise him in this house tonight. Well, I don't know about you, but I feel like there's about to be a mighty move of God up in this place. Amen? And we are so grateful that you have joined us tonight, whether you're watching online or you're here in the house. We are so glad that you've come to midweek service at World Harvest Church. There's no better place to be. Amen? And I want to actually speak to some VIP guests we have. Who is a first-time visitor in here tonight? Let's give a hand to our first-time visitors. Now, if you're a first-time visitor, we have a little bit of instruction for you. We want you to text VIP to the number that's on the screen on each side. If you can text VIP to that number, we can connect with you. And this is so important because at our church, we have a saying, and it's this: the first time you're a visitor, but after that, you're a part of our family. And we want to be able to connect with you so we can care for you, because your family, we love you. Amen. And speaking of connection, a great way to get connected in our church is to become a part of our Next Steps program. Let's give it up for Next Steps. This is a wonderful program that World Harvest Church has, and it's great for so many reasons. One, you get taught by great leadership, such as, but not limited to, our phenomenal pastor, Pastor Rob Parsley. Our elders, such as Elder Canfield, Elder Brunson, Pastor Tim Houston. It doesn't get much better than that. Also, you get to connect and create community with your fellow brothers and sisters in Christ right here. And something that I love and have benefited from so much in my life and grown from is that at Next Steps, we plug you into an area of ministry where we can steward and cultivate your unique calling and your unique gifts. It is a great program. You guys don't want to miss out, okay? So our next steps program is going to be June 10th, immediately after that service. So if you want to be a part, and I know you guys do, make sure you go out to the Connect Centers after service and sign up, okay? Now there's one more thing that I'm so excited to tell you guys about. This coming Sunday at 5 p.m., we are going to be having our first Mommy and Me fitness class. It's going to be great. And it's being presented by the best first daughter in all the world, Miss Ashton Parsley. She'll be presenting this alongside Miss Brittany Hudson. Now, you don't want to miss out on this because it's going to be a great time. And by the way, even if you don't have kids, we want you to come on out. But if you do, I want to tell you a little bit about the pricing for it. Now, the cost is $10 per unit. So let me break that down for you. If it's just you, it's one payment of $10. If it's you and one or two kiddos, still just $10. And if you're rocking those Pentecostal Duggar vibes and you have 15 kids, still just one payment at $10. Can't get better than that, huh? So you guys, make sure that you come out next Sunday at 5 p.m. Just bring yourself, bring your friends, bring your kids, bring your messy bun and yoga pants, because we're going to have a great time. It's going to be a time of faith, fun, fellowship, and fitness, and we can't wait to see you all there. Now, I have the privilege of bringing up one of the great leaders of our church, Pastor Cal Switzer. Let's make him welcome, everyone.
Isn't it exciting to be in World Harvest Church on Wednesday night? Tell somebody, I'm glad you're here, and let's be seated. Boy, you just... Mark chapter 2 says it was noised abroad that Jesus was in the house. The wonderful news, Jesus is always in the house here at World Harvest Church, and I want to say thank you for that. You know, Paul said it this way as we've been sensing and just worshiping our Jesus tonight. He said it's simple and basic in the Message Bible. It's all Jesus. Let's say Jesus. Let's say it again, Jesus. He said, make it simple, make it basic. Our walk in life is in Jesus, and everything else might help, but it's trappings. But when the day's done, it's all Jesus, and our walk in our service and our love and our adoration for our Jesus and our Father God. You know, with that, tonight, the privilege is we get to minister to God tonight with His resources and His finances that He has given us, and we become those wonderful stewards. But there's a verse that I want to share before we go into that. But the first question is, how many think it's okay to be free financially? No, not in heaven, because if I take a dead spirit on earth, I'm going to have to get it cast out of me before I get to heaven. So heaven is not the answer. Heaven's just a destination. Jesus is the answer. And so with that, let's say it again. How many are really thrilled and thankful and expecting in Jesus that we're to be financially free here on this earth? Makes it real simple. There's a, you know, we could do 14 million reasons why this and that, but it's real simple. Jesus makes it simple. In Matthew chapter 6, and I know we know the chapter, it's a wonderful, powerful chapter about prayer and fasting and giving and praying and all those areas. And then it goes into about seeking God first and all that's so important. That's it. But in between there in verse 24, it says that an individual cannot serve two masters. That word masters mean who is in control of my life? Who orders my thoughts? Who orders my financial structure? Who orders my time? Who orders everything that I do? That's the word master. And it says that we cannot serve two masters, because either we will love to one and hate the other one, or be loyal to one and not to the other one, or we'll honor one and we'll disrespect and not receive from the other one. We can't serve two masters that control our life. So then Jesus says it this way. He says, we either serve God or we serve money. And when he's talking about right there, he's wanting us to be released, because it says in the next verse that we're not to take cares or worries about what we eat or what we drink or what we wear or where we live or what we drive. Any of that, because we've already made a decision that we are going to serve one master, and his name is Jesus. Let's say Jesus. And it's important tonight that we just ground this inside of us, because it's not that we have God who gives us heaven and we serve him a little bit, but when it comes to the financial realm, we'll take care of that one. No, we're not to have pressures and cares and anxieties of all those areas of Mark chapter 4 tells us. So tonight, we're going to let Jesus minister to us by making it real simple and real basic, and that's making Jesus the Lord of our finances, because they don't belong to us anyways, they belong to him. Go up a few verses in verse 19 of chapter 6, and it says that we're not to lay up treasure on this earth, but we're to deposit our treasure in heaven by our love and by our giving. And though, so this evening, we're going to do something very special to be set free from financial debt, to be set free from generational curses where we live from paycheck to paycheck or never get to the next level of being blessed to be a blessing. You see, Satan wants to run our life financially, that every decision we make is on our checkbook amount that we have or don't have. That's called lordship, and it's the wrong lordship. Jesus wants to be our Lord by saying, I want to control your life. I want to control your spirit, your soul, your body, and your finances. And he wants us blessed real good. So this evening, as we hand out our envelopes, and we're going to do our giving by text of WHC and space and 45777, and online, there's a place that you can just click that button and you can join us. But this evening, we're going to make it simple. We're going to release the power of the enemy off our life by him controlling our life, by controlling us by finances. We're going to release it to Father God tonight as we give, as the envelopes are in front of you being passed out. You may use checks, you may use credit cards. That's wonderful. You can see on the big screens how to do our simple text giving, our smart giving. We're bringing that tithe to God, that 10% that belongs to him, that shows our love and shows our adoration and shows our trust. We go above that and say, Father, there's 90% left over that belongs to you. And I don't want finances to be my Lord, because behind that financial pressure is the real evil Lord. His name is Lucifer. So tonight, all of us together are going to have a release. being set free tonight as we minister to our Jesus, as we love him. And isn't it exciting that he uses finances and resources to be a tool to get closer to him, to love him, and to be set free so we can live for him. And tonight I want you to set that in your heart and mind, the areas of being set free financially this evening. Because where our treasure goes, our heart goes. And our treasure's going to God tonight as we start to lay up those treasures supernaturally. And on a Wednesday night, why not be free on this Wednesday night forever and ever and ever? Can we take that? Say thank you, Jesus. Father God, tonight we thank you that finances were never to be the battle of life. Finances were not called to be the Lord of life. And that's why you said we'll either serve money or we'll serve Jesus. And so, Father, we break that spirit off our life by the action of love, which is giving. For God so loved, he gave. And on Wednesday night right here, Father God, at the Harp, we thank you. There's such a freedom. We sense it. Such a liberty tonight. And we thank you as we bring your tithe and we bring our giving, which is yours, to you. We lay our treasure up in heaven by worshiping you, by investing in your kingdom, in all division of God's love right here at World Harvest Church. And we praise you for the turnarounds that happen now. Let's all say now. Let's say it again, now, in Jesus' name. And we all say it together. Come on, let's stand and praise God. Let's worship and praise him together.
He's found in you, yeah. Authentic Live, who I'm a little partial to, but I think they're amazing. It's good to see all of you tonight. And my name is Lisa Brunson, and hello to all of you. I'm going to do something that makes me comfortable because everybody's been saying, oh, she's preaching this week. And I'm like, no, I'm not really preaching. I'm not really a preacher. I'm just going to talk. That's what I'm going to do. But I'm going to do something to make myself feel a little more comfortable. So guys, put me in the key of E flat. So when I think about the Lord, how he saved me, how he raised me, how he filled me with the Holy Ghost, how he cleansed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up, turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. And we all say, it makes me wanna shout hallelujah, thank you Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all of the glory and all of the honor and all of the praise. It makes me wanna shout hallelujah, thank you Jesus. Lord, you're worthy of all of the glory and all of the honor and all of the praise. You may be seated. See, when I think about the Lord, when I just think a thought, when I just think a thought of how he filled me with the Holy Ghost and how he cleansed me to the uttermost. When I think about the Lord, how he picked me up, turned me around, how he placed my feet on solid ground. See, it makes me wanna shout. This is old school worship. Thank you, Jesus. Of all of the glory and all of the, sing it out, makes me want to shout. It makes me want to shout hallelujah. I say thank you, Jesus. Lord, you're worthy. And all of the and all of the, amen. So Father God, we thank you. We thank you that you reached down into pits lower than low and you brought us out. We thank you for your precious Holy Spirit. We thank you for your word that is life to us. It is breath. We thank you that you are always speaking because your word is always available. We bless you for your word. God, let what you want to be said go forth tonight. Let my words be your words. Let my thoughts be your thoughts. And let my actions be your action. And let my heart be your heart. Do something in this place tonight. And we will forever give you thanks and praise and glory. And the family of God and the family at World Harvest Church says, amen. Amen. So for real, you can be seated now. I have to say this, and I've been real emotional today. And I'm not going to apologize for it. Because I've been this way my whole life. And it was probably, 10 or 12 years ago, Pastor called me into this office, and it wasn't anything but just to say, I love you, and I think you're doing a great job. And so he says that to me, and I immediately start crying. And then I do what all women do immediately. I'm so sorry I'm crying. Like, you're just trying to say something good to me, and here I am like I'm sobbing, like uncontrollably, like unable to breathe. You know, that ugly cry? And he said something to me in that moment that changed my life and changed my perspective. And he said, don't ever apologize one more day for being emotional, because it's that sensitivity that makes you be able to hear and flow and move God. So I say that because I want to honor you. I love you. I thank you for every day answering the call of God. You know, some of us answer the call once in our lives. And then life happens, and so many pastors just stop. And one thing we can say about our pastor is that he never stops. He Marco Polo'd me today and was like, oh, do you want me to come in tonight? And I said, I want you to rest, because you did Sunday, and then you got on a plane Monday, and then you did Daystar Tuesday, and then you traveled back, and here he is. He never stops. He's like the Energizer Bunny, or he's like God, whichever you want to look at. But I honor you. I thank you. Miss Joni, I honor you. I love you like crazy. I'm your biggest fan, I think. Well, maybe not. Maybe, probably Pastor and your family are your biggest fans. And Miss Ashton and Austin, I think you guys are both amazing. To the leadership of our church and to just our church, you are all amazing. I hope you know how amazing you are, how blessed we are to have this family. And to my armor bearer tonight, who happens to be my husband, we're going to be celebrating 9 years of marriage next Wednesday. And he always says, we talk about this a lot. It was our first Sunday back here after we got married. And he said he was sitting back there and the Lord spoke to him and said, if all I ever called you to do was protect and cover her, would you do it? And he said, I didn't even have to think about it. I said, yes. Because before this is my ministry, my wife is my ministry. So thank you for always protecting and covering me. And to my family, sorry, I feel like I'm like receiving an award or something like that, but this is a big deal to me. My sissy, you drove up here, totally surprised me. Bella, Carter, Haley, I love you. I honor you guys. Okay, so I struggled with what I felt like the Lord told me to talk about tonight, because I kind of felt like in myself, like they're just going to want to hear something light from me. I mean, like, let's talk about the five layers of praise. Let's talk about worship, the difference between it. And he was like, no, I want you to talk about this. And I struggled with it until Sunday morning. And Sunday morning service was crazy, was awesome. And Pastor called up people that wanted to be delivered from alcohol. And he called them up, and then he called for people that have been delivered from alcohol. And our response was slow. And he said this, Your calling has a lot to do with your testimony. So in other words, what God has delivered you from has a lot to do with what He wants you to do. And so I want to talk to us tonight about shame. Because He said in that moment, why are you ashamed of what God has done in your life? And so is it okay if I pull this back a little bit? Okay. So He said that. And then I was like, okay, now I feel like that I can kind of share what I felt like in my heart God was saying. So we're going to talk a little bit tonight about shame. I want you to get your Bibles out, get a notebook out. I'm going to give you a ton of scripture because I believe that the Word of God is and has the answer to every problem you face in your life. And sometimes we struggle with things we ought not struggle with because we simply don't know what the Word of God says about it. So if shame is something that you're dealing with, we're going to put a little word on it tonight. Okay, so a lot of believers know, and we all know, that Christ forgave us of our sins, right? At the point we accepted Him as our Savior. He forgave us of our sins. But a lot of us carry around the shame from those sin. So what is shame? I'm going to define it for you real quick. Okay. Shame is the intensely painful feeling or experience, listen to this, of believing that we are flawed and therefore unworthy of love and belonging. That something we've done, something we've experienced, or something that we just didn't do makes us unworthy of connection. See, shame is different than guilt because guilt is judicial in its character, but shame is relational. Let me explain that, right? So say that we're being tried for something and the judge hands down the sentence that says you're guilty. So there is the pronouncement of guilt. But then what we have to deal with is the shame, or let me say it like this, the embarrassment of being convicted of the crime. Does that make sense? Okay. So shame says stuff like this. The pain you feel, that's your punishment. Shame says stuff like, you deserve it. Shame says stuff like, you're gonna have to pay for that the rest of your life. Shame is the voice that says, stay right where you are. Shame is the voice that says, you'll never be free. Shame, when it talks to us and we are consumed by it, manifests itself in a lot of different ways. For some of us, there is an incessant need to be busy so that we don't have to sit alone with our own thoughts. So let me fill myself, let me fill my days with serving and doing, and then I'm going to get home and I'm going to be exhausted and I'm going to cook dinner and then I'm going to sit down and watch TV and I can't even focus on the TV show, so I'm going to grab my phone and I'm going to scroll through social media because I don't want to be alone with my thoughts. So that's one way shame manifests in our lives. Another way shame manifests is through constantly proving or striving to show ourselves worthy. Let me just insert this a little bit. I'm going off my notes, but I read this the other day, and when I tell you it rocked my world, it rocked me. Think, we all know the story of when Jesus was baptized, right? John baptized him. The Holy Spirit descended from heaven in the form of a dove and said these famous words. This is my son in whom I am well pleased, right? Do you realize that Jesus had not performed a miracle at that point? His ministry hadn't even started. But we spend so much time striving and trying to prove to people our worth. And our Heavenly Father says, you don't have to do anything to prove your worth because you didn't love me before I loved you. Okay, so another way shame manifests is through depression, through anxiety, through fear, and through physical sickness. But tonight, God is saying to some of us in this room that we are going to go from being shameful to shameless. I just want to declare something. Some of us are about to change our clothes. Right? And that's going to make sense to you later in Isaiah 61. But we are about to change clothes. We're going to take off shameful and we're going to put on shameless. Okay? So let's read a little bit. All right? Turn to Genesis 3. And I'm going to speed through it for the sake of time. This is the first instance of shame that we see in the Bible. Genesis 3, starting at chapter 1. The serpent was the craftiest of all the creatures the Lord God had made. So the serpent came to the woman. Really, he asked, none of the fruit in the garden? God says you mustn't eat any of it? Of course we may eat it, the woman told him. It's only the fruit from the tree at the center of the garden that we are not to eat. God says we mustn't eat it or even touch it, or we will die. That's a lie, the serpent hissed. You'll not die. God knows very well that the instant you eat it, you will become like him, for your eyes will be opened and you will be able to distinguish good from evil. And the woman was convinced how lovely and fresh looking it was, and it would make her so wise. So she ate some of the fruit and gave some to her husband, and he ate it too. And as they ate it, suddenly they became aware of their nakedness and they were embarrassed. So they strung fig leaves together to cover themselves around the hips. That evening, they heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden, and they hid themselves among the trees. The Lord called to Adam and said, why are you hiding? And Adam replied, I heard you coming and didn't want you to see me naked. So I hid. Who told you you were naked? The Lord God asked. Have you eaten fruit from the tree I warned you about? Yes, Adam admitted. And like every good man, he said, but it was the woman who gave me the fruit, and I ate it. So then the Lord God goes down the line, and he asks the woman, how could you do such a thing? And like any good woman, she says, well, the serpent tricked me. It's his fault. So there are a few things I want us to draw out of this. Okay, the first thing is this. The enemy will always tell you that God's word isn't true, that his commands aren't true, and they aren't for you. And that's exactly what he did with Adam and Eve. This is the spirit of the world, or the spirit of the age that we're in. So we think, sitting in here, oh, I would never be Adam or Eve. If God told me not to do something, I would never do it. Really? The spirit of the world? Finance a lifestyle you can't afford. Bible, God says, owe no man nothing but to love him. Spirit of the world, promiscuity, sexuality. God says, Song of Solomon, don't wake up love before it's time. And then Jesus says, if you even look on a woman to desire her, then you've done it in your heart. But the spirit of the world says you can't even walk down the main aisle at Easton without seeing it paraded everywhere, right? Spirit of the world. It's okay to not have control of negative emotions. Be angry, be hateful, get on Facebook and Twitter and talk about politics. Stir up trouble. Go to Twitter wars, right? Say what you want, and if you're not bold enough to say it to their face, then just go on social media and say it. But Ephesians 4:29 says, let no foul or polluting language, nor evil word, nor unwholesome or worthless talk ever come out of your mouth, but only such speech as is good and beneficial to the spiritual progress of others, as is fitting to the need and the occasion, that it may be a blessing and give grace to those who hear it. Spirit of the world, gossip about them. Judge them. I am so sick of this. Side note, right? I mean, the wedding, I don't even know her name, but the people in England that got married, the prince and the princess, like, let the poor lady do her own makeup, let her wear the dress she wants to do, but we're gonna sit and judge everyone because that's the spirit of the world, or to be critical of everyone because that's the spirit of the world. But the word of God says, Matthew 7, don't judge or be critical, or you too will be judged and criticized. For in the same way you judge others, you will be judged, and with the measure you use it, it will be measured back to you. So if you feel like everybody's being critical towards you, maybe it's because you've been critical towards everybody else. Just throwing that out there, just food for thought, okay? Here's the thing that's crazy about this. God never said they couldn't eat. Like, can you imagine, like, walking through the Garden of Eden? It was, like, beautiful. There were probably, like, mango trees, if mangoes even grow on tree. Like, there were trees everywhere. There were probably hundreds of millions of trees. But God said, just don't do the one thing. Just don't do the one thing. You can have everything, but don't do the one thing. And, like, Adam and Eve, just like good humans do, they do the exact opposite of what God told them to do, or their authority figure told them to do. Okay? A couple other things. Out of this passage, shame was a result of the disobedience. Right? And we have to own that. Like, we have to take responsibility for that. And then Adam and Eve, they both blamed somebody else immediately. Not even a thought, right? Not even a thought. Neither of them took responsibility for their actions. And once the sin was committed, here's the thing that's so sad to me about it. Once the sin was committed, their perception was skewed. They didn't see things the way they used to see them. They didn't look at things the way they used to look at them. Instead of God being the friend that they were excited about spending time with, they hurt him and ran. Right? Sin will always do that to you. But here's the great thing about God. If God knows the end from the beginning, and he does, right? He knew what Adam and Eve had done before he ever walked down to the garden. And he still walked down to the garden. Okay? So there are some of us tonight that are dealing with things that we're like, oh my gosh, I did this. And 20 years later, I'm still like dealing with this. Right? And what God is saying to you tonight is that I'm still walking down to the garden. And tonight, we are going to overcome shame through and by the word of God. The first way you do it, right? And I'm going against like the churchy, you know, the thing, because I'll just say this. The first way you do it, the first way you overcome shame is to actually talk about it. Not like you've never sinned. Right? Talk about it and then believe in your heart and know according to the word of God that he has forgiven you. James chapter 5 says it like this. Confess your sins one to another and pray for each other. What? That you may be healed. We walk around emotionally broke, right? That's Kentucky vernacular. Emotionally broken. And all God says is just tell somebody that you messed up and let them pray for you. Because the earnest prayer of a righteous person has great power. And this is the thing I love about it. And the Bible says it produces wonderful results. Confession and prayer produce wonderful results. The biggest sinner in the Bible that we all know of, in my opinion, is probably David. He also says, the Bible also says he was a man after God's own heart. And so when he had done everything that he had done, he went and was talking to Nathan about it, right? And he said in 2 Samuel 12, he said, I have sinned against the Lord. So he took responsibility. And guess what Nathan said back to him? Yeah, you did, but the Lord has already forgiven you. And we carry the shame of something that God doesn't even remember. How? Why? Okay? I want you to write this down. If the enemy can keep you silent, he can keep you captive. Right? And this is in dealing with much more than shame. We walk through things in life and we walk through them alone, because we really don't believe the scripture that we overcome by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of our testimony, right? If the enemy can keep you silent, he can keep you captive. And that's simply a trap of the enemy. We call it this, my hidden sin. You know, I mean, that's not the sin that I can tell about in church, because that's too real. Like, I don't want anybody to know that sin about me. Like, I don't care if they knew that I went to the club every once in a while, but I don't really want them to know what I did at the club and who I did it with. Right? Like, I'll just keep that hidden because it's all under the blood. And then we deal with it still. At the most random moments, that thought will come over you. And it will wreck you like that. Really, all that is, what we say is hidden sin, is really, it's just basically pride. Okay? Proverbs 28, verse 13 says, a man who refuses to admit his mistakes will never be successful. But if he confesses and forsakes them, he gets another chance. Okay. Psalms 32 said, blessed is he whose transgression is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord does not impute wickedness, and in whose spirit there is no deceit. When I kept silent about my sin, my body wasted away through my groaning all the day long. My energy, my vitality, my strength was drained away like a hot summer day. This is Psalms 32, verses 1 through 5. But I acknowledged my sin to you, and I didn't hide my wickedness. Fast forward to verse 7. It says, you are my hiding place. You, Lord, protect me from trouble. You guys remember Pastor Phil, right? You surround me that Sunday morning with songs of deliverance, right? God is singing over you tonight, songs of deliverance. And not only that, you sing to me songs of deliverance and you shout over me. Be delivered! Will you stop? Whoa. Right? This work was completed on Calvary. Why are you carrying this? Stop. That's what God's saying to us tonight. Be delivered. It's done. It's over. Right? So the first thing we have to do to walk it out, is talk about it. Right? The second thing you have to do is to stop letting shame allow you to be lonely and to keep you bound. Okay, Psalm 68, one of my favorite scriptures in the Bible, says God sets the lonely in families. Look around, see your family, see your sister, see your brother, see your cousin, see your auntie, see your uncle, see your mama, see your daddy. He set you here for the sole purpose of you walking out this deliverance. He sets the lonely in families and he leads the prisoners out with singing. So first, you got to talk about it. Second, you have to stop allowing it to make you lonely and say, oh, nobody's ever experienced what I've experienced. Nobody's ever done what I've done. Right? And third, you have to stop letting shame nullify the power of God. Romans 8, the Spirit of God, we could all quote the scripture, right? The same Spirit that raised Christ Jesus from the dead is alive and lives in you and will quicken your mortal body. And see, we think that that's about the day of judgment when we're dead and the same Spirit comes down and raises us from the dead. And I think, let me just submit to you tonight, that that's not what he is talking about at all. What he is talking about is that it will raise you emotionally, spiritually, mentally from the dead. What good does the Spirit of God do you after you're gone? The Spirit that dwelled in Jesus, that invaded the borrowed tomb of Joseph of Arimathea, right? I do listen, right? It invaded that tomb. It's alive in you. Right? To heal you emotionally. To heal you spiritually. Some of you walk around with church hurt, and that's just shame. I'll leave it alone. Number four, stop letting shame make your heart cold. There's a movie. We have two little girls, Breezy and Reggie. Mommy loves you. Hope you're having fun with Mimi and Pappy. We have two girls. We're very girly. We love all things Disney. Please don't be judgmental. Okay? I'm just going to use this as an example to support the Word of God. Have any of you ever seen the movie Frozen? Yeah, okay. In that movie, this statement is made. Only an act of true love can unthaw a frozen heart. Take a look at the screens.
Elsa, you can't run from this.
Just take care of my sister.
Your sister? She returned from the mountain weak and cold. She said that you froze her heart. I tried to save her, but it was too late. Her skin was ice. Her hair turned white. Your sister is dead because of you.
No. yourself for me? I love you.
So, Jesus' death was the ultimate act of love. And the cross defines love and everything we think about it. John says this, "This is love. Not that we loved God, but that He loved us." Messed up, screwed up, doesn't have it all together, us. And He loved us so much that He sent His Son as the sacrifice for our sins. Ephesians 3 says, "I pray that Christ will be more and more at home in your heart, living within you as you trust in Him. May your roots go down deep into the soil of God's marvelous love. And may you be able to feel and understand, as all God's children should, how long, how wide, how deep, and how high His love really is. And to experience the love for yourselves, though it is so great that you will never really see the end of it or fully understand it, but at least you will be filled up with God Himself." I want to make this statement to you. The same God that set the stars in the sky, if He can set the stars in the sky and command them to stay, He's the same God that can heal your heart. He's the same God that can heal your heart. My loved ones, I wish above all things that you prosper and that you be in health, not just physical health, but that you be in health as your soul prospers. I want to read one more scripture to you, and then I'm going to pray and we're going to be done. But it's out of Isaiah chapter 61. We know it very well because our pastor brought one of the greatest sermons a man has ever preached about it. And it says this: "The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, and it's upon you, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the suffering and afflicted. He has sent me to comfort the brokenhearted, to announce liberty to the captives, to open the eyes of the blind. He sent me to tell those who mourn that the time of God's favor to them has come, and the day of His wrath is to their enemies. To all who mourn in Israel, He will give beauty for ashes, joy for mourning, and praise for heaviness." But here's this part of that passage that I had never realized until I read this. Verse 7 says, "Instead of shame and dishonor, you will have a double portion of prosperity and everlasting joy." Instead of shame and dishonor, you will have a double portion of prosperity and everlasting joy. And the last verse says, "Let me tell you how happy God has made me." Remember, I said at the beginning that we were going to change our clothes, going to go from shameful to shameless. He says, "For He has clothed me with garments of salvation and draped about me the robe of righteousness." I'm like a bridegroom in his wedding suit, or a bride with her jewels. Instead of shame and dishonor, you will have a double portion of prosperity and everlasting joy. Let's all stand together. I just want to pray over us. Father God, we thank You tonight for setting us into a family. We thank you that your Holy Spirit is now taking shame from us. Supernaturally, things that were done to us, things that we did to others, we give it to you. We thank you that your blood covers, it cleanses, and it redeems. Father God, we love you tonight because you are good and you do all things well. And Romans 8:28 really is true, that you work all things together for the good of those that love him. So let us now go into our world. Let us talk about your cleansing and redeeming power. Let us be the church. Let us share your love. Let us save, help to save others by the word of our testimony. Father, we pray for this surrounding community, for the 576,000 people that are right outside these doors that know you, that don't know you. Let us go into our communities. Let us invade them with your spirit, with your power. Let us not attend church anymore, but let us go from attending the church to being the church. Let us be your hands and feet. Father, we give our lives to you right now. We give over everything to you and we say, take it, have your way with it. We give it to you. We don't want it anymore. You take it and use it for your glory like only you can. We love you. We love you. You are good. You are great. And we give you praise. And the church says together, a resounding amen. Amen. You, Pastor Cal. Amen. Pastor Cal is gonna come and work it out for us. I love you guys. Thank you for allowing me the opportunity. I had fun. It was awesome.
Miss Lisa, thank you for giving us what our Daddy God wanted us to have tonight for the rest of our life. Those old filthy garments of shame are off us. Come on, shake them off. Let's be seated just for a minute. Miss Lisa, thank you for sharing. There is more power in sharing our weaknesses than in sharing our strengths. And I know in a few minutes we're going to be out of here, but there's a response of love tonight that we're going to allow that strength and that confidence and that joy in Jesus to just invigorate us, empower us. Tonight was a word that our Father God has been reserving for a whole lot of years and decades and generations, especially for us tonight, to see us free. And tonight we're going to get rid of the shame that has tried to hold us back and curtail us, as Miss Lisa shared that, and keep us bound up and hoping one day when we get to heaven it'll be okay. When, as we heard, Jesus already says it is okay. We're accepted, the beloved, right now. I'm standing on a platform right now, which Father God has spoken so strongly to all of us and through our pastor, that there's a world that needs to be set free from shame. And they're not hearing the voice. They're hearing echoes. They're hearing it's okay to be this or be that when God's crying in heaven and saying, I've set this world free. Will somebody tell them no more shame, but love? And that's what God has called us to do as a church. And this evening, I'm really standing on the face of World Harvest Church. I'm standing on God's face right here, right there. He's saying, I want the whole world to have this message. And I want it to be in person. And I want it to be in television. And I want it to be online. And we're doing something supernatural by saying, it's time for this face lift in faith lift. And so we can bring Jesus to our world like we've never done before. And it's been grand up to this point. But it's so many times more, Pastor, than even what you're seeing in your heart. And so this evening, real quickly, we're going to say, I'm going to share out of my weakness. Because there's a double portion of blessing, a double portion of increase in joy. And we're gonna make sure we all have our envelopes tonight, our faith lift envelope, real quickly. You may be right there, you'll get on the screen too, how I can give towards our faith lift tonight. And how we can say we want everyone in our world to be shameless. And we want to share tonight to be free from the shame that's tried to hold us back. There you'll see how we can smart text tonight. And we know that we are giving at least $20 every time we're together. But you know what? That's sweet. And I want to thank God for all of us that have given. But tonight we're saying, I want to be set free from this shame forever and ever. Jesus has already provided it. And my step of faith and of love tonight and the seed that I show will show that I'm shameless by letting others know about the Jesus that we have in our heart that set us free. And so tonight, what a step of love and a contact point with Jesus. As we take our envelope, some have already said, I've got my 20 out. That's fantastic. You see, we want to make sure as family, this is our position, that we're saying we're taking care of this, everything on the platform, everything in this church and this faith lift. If you need an envelope still, ushers are just getting them out. Thank you. Every one of us. For those that have said, here's 20, I think that some are going to do a lot more tonight. Forget that 20. Let's do 40, that 60, that 80. There's a double here tonight that's so sweet in Jesus. There's a double blessing. And for all the junk and guilt and shame and condemnation that the enemy has tried to place on us, there's a double confidence and joy and peace and strength. So tonight, let's sow from the weakness we've had to receive God's strength. All over tonight, let's make it real. You might want to write on your envelope, this is the areas that I am confessing my weakness, that I'm freed in Jesus. And now there's a double that my Father God's got for my life. Because I'm at the right place at the right time doing the right thing tonight. Now, Father, we thank you for it in Jesus' name. Oh, we just thank you for how you just lived and freed us through Miss Lisa tonight. We thank you that we saw the heart and the face of our Father God this evening. And that the shame is broken off our lives not to come back, because we've got Jesus who has made us shameless. As we sow tonight, we're saying, Father, I release all the weakness and shame that I've had. And I want to be used by you to bring this shamelessness to others. And I want to be part of it in my church family, because we do this together. And oh, Father, we thank you that through this church and through our pastor and through everyone here, we get to bring Jesus to our world. So thank you tonight as I sow and give. And oh, I thank you that it's a faith lift to our lives. And I praise you for it now in Jesus' name. Now in just these 7 or 8 or 9 or 10 seconds, just thank him personally that we're free on the inside. We're free in our emotions. We're free in every area because of what Jesus Christ has done for our life. And let's say it. Thank you, Jesus. I love you. Come on, let's stand up. Give him a praise, all right? Just give him a big thanksgiving from your heart. Give him a big smile. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. I'm glad for Wednesday nights, aren't you? Thank God. The ushers are receiving right now all this wonderful seed that we're sowing towards all the changes that are happening on the platform, making sure that we're doing our part and God's blessing us in a big way. And as the ushers are up and down the aisles, boom, there you go. Place it right in. Thank you so much. Let's not forget about this Sunday coming up. Memorial Sunday means we got lots of people we can bring. Let's bring them to church on Sunday. They'll receive what God's got as our pastor gives that supernatural power, that word, and the presence of God to everyone. So how many know somebody that could need to be shameless? Can I see your hand? Right now, we're going to start to think about them. We're going to invite them, text them. We're going to say, hey, I want to bring you to church on Sunday. That's so important to be part of this family. Let's make sure it happens. Let's not forget about summer cool, everybody. It's just around the corner, our all-day camp for our children right here, going right to August, the first week. Go back to our Connect Centers and say, I need to get my kids involved in that. This is the place right here that they'll be blessed, spirit, soul, and body, the entire summer. There's no camping like it, so go out there, Get yourself signed up. There's still some room. And all the mamas and their children, they've got this 5 p.m. this Sunday with Miss Ashton. You want to be there. You want to register. You don't want to miss it. Now there's a world waiting for us. Let's go out and let's go bring him Jesus. We love you.